So that was 2 Timothy chapter 3. And we're going to start at verse 10. You, however, know all about my teaching, my way of life, my purpose, faith, patience, love, endurance, persecutions, sufferings, what kinds of things happened to me in Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra, the persecutions I endured. Yet the Lord rescued me from all of them. In fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted, while evildoers and impostors will go from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. But as for you, continue in what you've learnt and have been convinced of, because you know those from whom you learnt it, and how from infancy you've known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work.
Good morning to you. My name is Orlando. I get a chance to open up God's word this morning and lead us through this next part of our gathering. And what a day it is. What a gathering this is. Libby and myself, will miss hugely those that we've been able to partner alongside in friendship, but also in common cause with the gospel. It's been such a joy. And can I say, Pete and Susie in particular have been the most wonderful partners that we could ever have hoped for here at Christ Church, and for us on the staff team, and for me personally as well. This is a big day, but we trust the Lord Jesus to carry us through not just today, but the decades ahead. So let's pray now as we turn to his word. Our Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your great kindness to us. Thank you for those who have ministered the gospel to us, who've taught us the scriptures, who've encouraged us, rebuked us, corrected us, trained us in righteousness with your word in their hands. We pray that you would equip both us here at Christ Church and this new church, the ministry at Trinity Church Salisbury, to be found faithful in handling your word in the years ahead, all that you give us to serve the name of the Lord Jesus. Please give us all attention and focus this morning as we listen to your word and are guided by it to serve you in that way. For Jesus' sake. Amen. 400 years ago, one of the most famous voyages in the world began right here in the city of Salisbury. The Mayflower set sail, bound for the New World. It was a dicey journey. It went as a ship with another ship, her sister ship, the Speedwell, which kept springing leaks, so they had to stop in Dartmouth and again in Plymouth for repairs. They eventually had to abandon her completely. A storm almost completely disabled the ship at mid-ocean. A man was swept overboard. Winds prevented the ship from landing in Virginia as planned. A horrific winter prevented them from going ashore and planting crops and building shelter. They had to spend the whole winter on the ship. Half the passengers and the crew died of terrible diseases during those cold months. The rest would likely have died were it not for the help of the Native Americans locally. It was not easy going, but those pilgrims were boosted all the way by an extraordinary, clear-sighted sense of purpose. They were a new Israel on their way to build a new Jerusalem in a new promised land. This was God's commission that they were carrying out, and they were doing it to God's glory. Well, it may seem a little grand to compare a trip up the A36 to Salisbury with that epic journey across the ocean to establish Christian America. But in essence, That is what we are marking today, the departure of a small group of Christian brothers and sisters from our midst here in Southampton to live and work in a new place, to begin a new life, to form a new community, a new family, a new body. This is a significant moment. And so we want today to rejoice in the possibilities that lie ahead, don't we? The great things God may do through the ministry of Trinity Church Salisbury. We want to dream of new life and new growth and new hope for the people of Salisbury and around. But this is a hard moment too, isn't it? We've had a few weddings over the summer, you may have noticed, here among us as a church and also further afield in terms of people you know elsewhere. They've made very happy days. But the feelings on a wedding day are complicated. For the bride's parents, for example, that little girl that they've loved and nurtured since she was this big is now leaving them and forming a bond with someone else. Yes, there's joy, but there's also, well, grief, isn't there? Just a bit. And they might numb it with the usual platitudes, we're not losing a daughter, we're gaining a son, but the truth is they are losing something. And they know it. And it's complicated even for the bride. Yes, there's enormous excitement about the new future she's embarking on with the man that she loves. But isn't there also a tinge of nervousness? How is this all going to work out? Are we going to make it? It seems to me it's not unlike that today. Here we are, the body of Christ known as Christ Church Southampton, and we're deliberately tearing off not just a little stray eyelash, but a whole huge limb. We're looking at people that we love, people that we've partnered with, that we've done life with, and we're sending them off to an uncertain future. And yes, of course there's joy, but there's certainly some grief too, isn't there? And you, the members of the Trinity launch team, you're excited about this new life together that you're setting out on. We'll be praying for you on Wednesday night as you covenant together and begin that journey. But I wouldn't mind betting there's a hint of nervousness even for you. The statistics about church plant survival are, well, they're just as depressing as they are for marriages. So naturally, you're all going to be wondering, how is this going to work out? So yesterday is a significant day, but it's also a hard day. Lots going on here. It's complicated. A whole range of different emotions. But for the moment, I want to address just that last one. The uncertainty. The nervousness. The anxiety that asks, how is this going to work out? It's the question about outcomes. I'm sure the pilgrims aboard the Mayflower turned that question over and over again in their minds as they crossed the ocean through those storms. How will this end up? I'm sure, as I say, every couple who gets married quietly wonders it. How will this turn out? And we are all wondering it today, aren't we? As we think about this new departure, Trinity Church Salisbury, how will it turn out? But here's the thing about Christian ministry as the New Testament has it. You've got to ask the right questions. And the question the Apostle Paul wants us to ask is not, what is the destination of this ministry? It is, what is the pattern for this ministry? And not where is this ministry going to end up in the future, but how is this ministry going to be carried out, worked out in the present? In 2 Timothy 3 and 4, Paul has a number of steers to give his protege, Timothy, about the kind of ministry that holds Jesus high. But he starts off in the second half of chapter 3 with just two things that are needed to get the church where it needs to be. You can see that's where he's heading. That's what the subject is by looking at the very last verse of the chapter. If you've got it there in front of you, you see it? 2 Timothy 3, verse 17. So that, what? So that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. That's what we're building up to. That's the subject here. What kind of ministry is needed to produce servants of God in places like Salisbury? Even Southampton, perhaps. Who are thoroughly equipped for every good work. Well, it turns out there are two things in his mind. And the first is this, the visible endurance of God's people. The visible endurance of God's people. Verse 10. You, however, know all about my teaching, my way of life, my purpose, faith, patience, love, endurance, persecutions, sufferings. What kinds of things happened to me in Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra? The persecutions I endured. One of the phrases that's entered into our vocabulary as a society since COVID is the term quiet quitting. You come across that expression? It's used to describe the attitude of an employee who refuses to do any more than the job actually strictly requires. I'm no longer going to try and be the first into the office every day. I'm not going to stay late just because there's a deadline. I'm not going to take on that person's responsibility when she's ill just because she can't do it and she's off work. It's not my job. I'm just going to do what I'm paid to do and not a jot more from this point on. Now, in some contexts, I'm sure it is a much-needed correction. Might not win you that many friends, or get you promoted, but if work is taking over life, you've got to do something, haven't you? Maybe quiet quitting is the answer for some. But it can never be in ministry. It can't be for the Christian believer who wants to be useful to the kingdom. Now, do you see how for Paul, ministry does seep out into the whole of life, every crevice. He doesn't just clock off at 5 o'clock and say, well, I'm done now, this is me time for the rest of the day. His ministry is totally bound up with his discipleship, his way of life, his love, his patience, all those things. It's all part and parcel of the same thing for him. Now, why is that? Well, it's because of the first words of verse 10. You, however, know all about my dot, dot, dot. That is, for one thing, Paul is different from those abusive, hypocritical, self-focused characters he's just been describing in the first half of the chapter. You can skim over and see what he's talking about there. That's the however, the start there. But more than just being different to them, he's aware that that difference is itself visible and powerful. You, however, know all about my teaching, my way of life, and so on. There it is in verse 14 again. But as for you, continue in what you've learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it. You know. Visible character, that is, observed godliness, is a powerful tool in commending the gospel. This week saw the retirement of perhaps the greatest female tennis player of all time, Serena Williams. She's broken just about every single record there is to break. An extraordinary player. She and that Wilson Blade tennis racket of hers, they've conquered the world. Now just imagine you're the marketing director of Wilson tennis racket. So, and with Serena, you know, hanging up her racket, you're going to have to find some more customers, aren't you? Maybe you start selling tennis rackets to a new generation of aspiring female tennis players, for example. Now, what do you do if that's the situation you're in? What approach do you take? Now, you could just put a nice web page together, I'm sure, listing all the advantages of your rackets, all the stats and everything, show you how they're so much better than anybody else's. And I'm sure that might appeal to some. But what about this? What about getting Serena Williams to speak to camera directly and speak from the heart and say, Wilson rackets are the rackets that have made me the great player I am today. I would not be where I am were it not for my trusty Wilson blade. And you could be saying the same thing too if you can somehow get your hands on a blade. It's a lot better, isn't it? It works better. I mean, to be fair, Serena Williams could probably thrash most of us on a tennis court if he gave her a frying pan to play with, or, I know, a packet of frozen hamburgers. But you get the point. Track record, the power of a changed life, offers a tremendously powerful commendation to the watching world of the thing that's changed it. And for Paul, that thing that's changed him is the gospel of Jesus Christ. Which is why all Timothy needs to do is continue. Keep going in what he's picked up. Because you know those from whom you learned it. But you notice, Paul homes in on one particular aspect of character as perhaps the most powerful commendation of all of the gospel. Look back at verse 10 and see if you can follow the logic of that list of character traits that he draws attention to. Let me read from verse 10 again. You, however, know all about my teaching, which is in accord with my way of life, which is itself a manifestation of my purpose, and shows itself specifically in my faith, my patience, and my love, but most of all, in my endurance in the face of persecutions and sufferings. For example, what kind of things happened to me in Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra, the persecutions I endured, which weren't terminal, as it turned out. The Lord rescued me. But they are inevitable for the Christian. Verse 12. Everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. You see the logic? Do you see how it hangs together, the sequence there? And if you do see that, you'll see two things that happen when people do notice the quality of a consistent Christ-directed life. One is more persecution. Everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. But two, more power in commending Christ, and all the more as we respond well to the persecution. We become those who are known for our endurance and therefore impact the watching world. This is what faithful and effective ministry consists of in part. This is what adorns the gospel and makes ready listeners of those who are still in darkness. And actually, more than that, it's what encourages and spurs on people who are already in the kingdom of light, but who are facing battles of their own. The visible endurance of God's people is a powerful thing. Those of you who are seeking to establish under God this new work in Salisbury, can I say to you, I hope you recognize what you've signed up for. I hope you are fully prepared for this aspect of the ministry that you are embarking on. The honeymoon will end. Things will get difficult. They'll get difficult for you as individuals if you remain faithful. All sorts of tests may lie ahead of you. Frustrations, rejections, irritations, maybe even persecutions. And they'll get difficult for you too as a church if you remain faithful. I was talking this week with a friend who's a pastor in another city in England. About a year or so ago, he signed a petition to the government about an issue of sexuality and the way it was being dealt with. The local newspaper published his name and the name of his church as one of those who had outrageously signed this persecution. And the next thing he knew, the school where they had been meeting for years decided they didn't want the church to meet there anymore. No reason given. More than that, the building firm that they just contracted with to get to work on a major development of the building they just bought suddenly pulled out. No reason given. There will be a need for endurance in the face of tests for you in Salisbury as there will be for us in Southampton. But respond well with steadfastness and grace, and you will see great things happen for the kingdom of God. Let's just look at the other ingredient of Christ-honoring ministry that Paul wants to draw attention to. Not just the visible endurance of God's people, but the tireless deployment of God's word. I don't know if you've ever had much use for a surgeon, but imagine if you did, you might be keen to know something about the person that you're entrusting yourself to on that table. Maybe you'd be tempted to look them up on the internet, check out their qualifications, read their professional profile, perhaps. Maybe even skim through some reviews of former patients. Do those exist? Can you get those? I don't know if they're a thing or not, but I imagine they probably are. Now, suppose you did that. You did that search on the internet, and you found that profile on your surgeon whose table you'll be on next week. What would you think if this was what you read? Mr. Jones is a valued member of the team and one of our most creative and open-minded surgeons. Depending on what he finds, he can be relied on to employ the most original instruments for the job in hand, however unconventional, as well as his scalpel, forceps, retractors, and scissors. He's often seen by operating theatre staff reaching for such novel tools as a garden trowel, kitchen whisk, croquet mallet, and of course, his own trademark belt sander. Mr. Jones takes a multidisciplinary approach to his surgery, making good use of insights gained from his pastime as an amateur carpenter, his observation of his primary age daughter's papier-mâché project, and from his experience as a bomb disposal expert in the Territorial Army. He truly is one of the most innovative surgical minds of his time, and has requested that if his biography is ever written, the title should be the maxim he lives and works by. If in doubt, try it out. What do you think? How would you be feeling about your operation next week with Mr. Jones? Like you're in good hands? Now, it's ridiculous and laughable, obviously, but here's the thing, and it's a serious point, actually. There are churches and ministries up and down the country and around the world that have, in effect, just that attitude to Christian ministry. Yes, they've got the conventional tools in the bag. Yes, they've got their Bible, they've got prayer. But they're considered good for some things, those conventional tools. But in the attitude of those ministries, not much more than that. There's a raft more things in the bag. A bit of popular psychology, a bit of Eastern meditation, other spiritual techniques, a touch of political know-how, some motivational speaking, psychometric testing and evaluation, music performance, a visual spectacle, a general entertainment, basic sociology, the list goes on. Whole ministries are built on a deliberately broad base of tools, just like what's in that kit bag. The Word of God is there, but it's reduced to just one tool among many. But you see how that flies in the face of what Paul says here in these verses. Look, just look how wide-ranging the Bible is in its usefulness. For a start, it can draw people to know God in the first place. Verse 15, from infancy you've known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. Now, lots of other things that can help somebody pay attention, I suppose, to the gospel, but it's only the contents of the Bible, and specifically what it says about Jesus, that can actually, as the Spirit works in their hearts, draw them in to the kingdom. That's why the best evangelistic tools and resources and courses and talks and all the rest of it are the ones which really rub people's noses in the Bible. And that's unleashing God's power to work in them. So the Bible is good for that, drawing people to know God. But then see how it's good for them to grow in their Christian walk too. What does he say? All Scripture, verse 16, is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. Teaching. Now, we all need to develop the mind of God. The Bible will help us do that. Rebuking. We all go wrong. We need to be shown our error. The Bible will enable us to do that as well. Correcting. That is not just pointing out the error, but putting us back on the right track. Again, the Bible's got that covered. Training in righteousness. Just generally getting our minds and our hearts, our decisions, our ambitions, our priorities, our values, all those things on track with God and in keeping with the people that we are in Christ. The Bible's got what we need for that too. And more than that, actually getting us serving, verse 17, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. The Bible gives us the resources we need for that too. Drawing people into the kingdom, building them up in the kingdom, and putting them to work in the kingdom. Everything we need is here. Having a Bible in your pocket is like having one of those multi-tools that, the other ones, the Leathermans and so on. Every 5 years or thereabouts, my wife buys me a new Leatherman multi-tool. After about a year, I lose it, inevitably, and I spend the next 4 years conquering my embarrassment and working up the courage to ask her for another one. That's how it works for us in our household. It's just the basic dynamic, a five-year cycle. There it is. But the reason there's a reason I lose it, and that is because I use it so much. So many attachments. Can do just anything, inside or outside, far away, intricate, anything. So it could end up anywhere. That's my excuse anyway. If you've seen the movie 127 Hours, you'll know that a multi-tool can even help when you're climbing in the wilderness and get your hand jammed in a rock, leaving you in a situation where you'll die of thirst and exhaustion if you don't do something drastic. I won't spoil the plot for you, but let's just say my earlier comments about surgeons using inappropriate tools doesn't necessarily apply in all situations. The Bible, it is our multi-tool. It's good for our work for the kingdom of God in every area, and not surprising, considering where it comes from. Beginning of verse 16, all Scripture is God-breathed. Yes, it was human writers who put pen to paper, as it were, but even as they wrote, there was an author in the background standing behind them, ensuring that the things they wrote were his words. This is the ministry that you, the people of Trinity Church, and that we, the people of Christ Church, are called to. Recognizing the universal usefulness of the Bible and responding to that by making sure it is the first resource we reach for in all areas of our ministry. We echo God's words in order to build people up in God's kingdom. The story of Cyrano de Bergerac is an enduringly popular story, but it's a story which has much to teach us of Christian ministry here. It tells of an army officer, Cyrano, a great wordsmith, as it happens, who loves a particular woman, but that woman does not love him back. Now, a younger officer also loves the same woman, but has no words with which to woo her. And so what happens is the first officer, Cyrano, the wordsmith, writes letters to the woman, which are signed and delivered by the younger officer. In response, she falls in love with that younger officer. He is actually, sadly, immediately killed in battle. And she's lost for the time being. But eventually she learns that the letter's real author is Cyrano. And right at the end, she ends up falling in love with him, the first author of those letters. Now, we in ministry are those who reach for God's words to serve those around us. And yes, we will grow in our relationships with those people, but our ultimate aim is to make them fall in love, not with us, but with God, the God who loves them and sent Jesus for them. Do that in Salisbury, and the spiritual work you will achieve could well be as significant as the voyage of the Mayflower and as enduring as the strongest lifelong marriage there is. Endure and keep reaching for the Word of God and just see what that God will do. A moment of quiet and I'll pray. Our Heavenly Father, those are great things to mark any ministry. That visible endurance and that complete dependence on your word. And we pray as you've impressed those things on our heart through your word today, they would stay with us, the people of Christ Church Southampton, and stay with those who are launching Trinity Church Salisbury, so that both our churches would be true displays of your glory, would be faithful and fruitful, and in the end cause the new creation to be populated by more and more who bow the name to the Lord Jesus. Amen.